This morning, an update on the crisis in public housing, the threat to close a number of senior centers, and the battle cry to City Hall, show us the money. Plus, the constitutional crisis brewing in Washington, a contempt of Congress citation for the Attorney General, a subpoena for the president's eldest son, and a report on Trump's taxes that refute his claim,
I'm really rich.
Now, from 42nd and 2nd, this is PIX 11 News Close-Up with Marvin Scott.
Good morning. House Speaker Nancy Pelosi declared this week that the country is in a constitutional crisis as President Trump asserted executive privilege to block Democrats from obtaining the full report of Special Counsel Robert Mueller. The House Judiciary Committee retaliated by holding Attorney General William Barr in contempt of Congress for refusing to produce the document. On top of that, a New York Times investigation punctured Trump's credibility by revealing he amassed such a huge financial loss that he didn't pay any taxes over an eight-year period several decades ago. Now, as all of that was unfolding, a Republican-led Senate committee issued a subpoena for the president's son to testify. In the first known subpoena of a member of the president's family, Donald Trump Jr. is being called by the Republican-led Senate Intelligence Committee. It was not immediately clear why he's being subpoenaed, but a source close to him said he'll not participate in what he called a publicity stunt, but will provide answers to written questions. If tensions weren't already escalating between the Democrats and President Trump, they went up yet another notch as Democrats on the House Judiciary Committee voted to hold Attorney General William Barr in contempt of Congress for refusing to comply with their subpoenas to see the unredacted version of the Mueller report.
This is information we are legally entitled to receive, and we are constitutionally obligated to review.
President Trump, before heading to a rally in Florida, was quick to jump in to short-circuit the Democrats' demands by invoking executive privilege to shield the full report and underlying evidence from Congress.
The Attorney General is protecting information, grand jury information, confidential information that he cannot release.
Trump, who remains under fire for refusing to release his tax returns, had the credibility of one of his popular campaign refrains under question.
I'm really rich. I'll show you that in a second.
In a devastating report, the New York Times cast doubt on that claim, revealing that when he was a real estate mogul, he suffered staggering losses, over $1 billion during a nine-year period from 1985 to 1994, according to the New York Times. Trump appears to have lost more money than nearly any other individual American taxpayer. The Times claims Trump lost so much money he paid no federal income taxes for a period of 8 years. President Trump lashed out, calling the report a hit job and tweeting that you always wanted to show losses for tax purposes. Almost all real estate developers did and often renegotiated with the banks. It was sport. And this week, the state Senate here in New York passed a bill that could open Trump's returns. The measure authorizes Congress to obtain the state tax returns of any resident. The bill does not specifically target Trump, but if it does pass the Assembly as expected, it could unlock his financial dealings. Joining me now to discuss this week's developments is political strategist Hank Scheinkoff and Republican strategist Chapin Fay, who is with the Mercury Group. Gentlemen, thank you. Do you agree with Nancy Pelosi? Are we in the constitutional crisis?
We're always in a constitutional crisis, except this one is more pronounced. The battle between the legislature and the executive is not a new one. The need for the courts to intervene is not a new thing. The difference here is that the president has told his those he's appointed not to comply in any way with the Congress. That's a different issue.
But isn't he... the Democrats are saying he's still, by taking these actions, is obstructing justice.
Well, listen, this isn't a constitutional crisis. I mean, this isn't the cannons at Fort Sumter. What are we talking about here? This is something that's happened before. Congress has held an attorney general in contempt of Congress before. I don't recall the speaker saying that it was a constitutional crisis then. Maybe it was because it was a Republican Congress and a Democrat president. By the way, in that scandal, the Fast and the Furious, there was an American death involved. And Republicans negotiated 4 months before taking the extraordinary measure. This time, Democrats waited days. This is all, more of the the political play to drive impeachment.
Well, that may be so, but maybe not. This is much more complicated. There are foreign issues involved. There's potential espionage, misuse of office, as well as financial implications, and the president's failure to even comply or discuss anything that is at all goes against his interests with the Congress. This is a little bit more complicated than that. And there are larger questions of violations of law than we had in that incident.
No, Nancy Pelosi says the president is almost self-impeaching because he's refusing to comply with wishes of the Congress. This is not the first time the legislative and the executive branch have been in conflict.
Well, I mean, I think that's another proof positive that this is all a farce, right? Nancy Pelosi this week blamed Trump for them not being able to impeach him. And if this was such a big constitutional crisis, why aren't they beginning impeachment? That's proof positive that this is a farce. This is all political theater. This is the Democrats trying to smear the president. They can't get to the president, so they're going to smear the attorney general. By the way, I think you'll see in years to come that they're doing this to soften him up before he uncovers what really happened and what really went on for the last couple of years.
Well, I'm not sure about that, but what is clear and what is much more pronounced and much more difficult for the president is to go back to his base of voters and to tell them how he didn't pay any income taxes for all those years. You know, he talked about draining the swamp in Washington. He was the hero of the blue-collar white Catholic in the Midwest. He's now kind of losing that because he's just like everybody else. And the impeachment stuff is just a way for him, frankly, to get beyond that problem. He will blame the Congress, but he can't blame the Congress for his own personal behavior as a rich guy.
I think many Democrats are now saying they feel it would hurt them if they instituted impeachment proceedings.
True. I think that's entirely true.
When you have some 20 candidates running for president for next year. Now, what about the fact Mitch McConnell said, case closed, talking about the Mueller report investigating whether Russia was involved in the 2016 campaign, and now a Republican-led Senate committee is set a subpoena out for the president's son, Don Jr.? What do you make of that?
I don't think that Senator Burr got the memo that the case was closed. But I think that, you know, Don Jr. has already testified. He gave hours and hours of testimony. I'm not sure what new we can learn. I mean, even in the New York Times article, everything that comes out is not necessarily new. You know, we have the media scrutinizing everyone, you know, 24 hours a day. We've got, you know, influencers and social media scrutinizing everyone every hour of every day. I don't know that these big bombshell things that come out are anything new. We already knew Donald Trump had declared bankruptcy and maybe didn't pay taxes. If you don't make money, you don't pay taxes. And I think his base understands that.
What about Mueller? He said he will not block him testifying. Congress wants him to come before their committees and hear his testimony, which he says conflicts with what the attorney general has released in the report.
It's a smart move to get Mueller in to testify for the president because then they can attack Mueller. This is a great chess game. Every time the Democrats get any steam, Donald Trump finds a way to move the action in a different direction. You know, the problem is, too, it's kind of like the late great entertainer Jimmy Durante, which some of our audience may or may not remember. You know, he would say, look, everybody wants to get in the act. You know, getting the 5 minutes of fame is a pretty important thing, and that's what a lot of these politicians are doing.
Why is the Senate committee calling Don Jr.? If the Russia probe is closed, what are they looking for?
I mean, if you can give me an answer for that, you know, if anyone can give you an answer for that, I'd like to hear it. I don't think there is an answer. I think that he, this is more of the fishing expedition. They can't, you know, they haven't been able to win or get information or, the Mueller report came out and it was not really case closed, but it was a prosecutor saying there's not enough to take this ball any further down the court. And now they're just trying whatever they can.
That's not what the prosecutor report said. What the report said is that he left it to Congress to make the decision about action to take pending information that would become available. That's number one. Number two, the question with Don Jr. is much more serious because it goes right to the issue of Russian interference in the election and the attempt to undermine democracy. That is a larger question, a much more significant one than all the dough and everything else.
Where do you see this going?
Same way it's been going. We're going to have these, like Hank said, this is a giant political chessboard, and we're going to have this back and forth until the president is either reelected or not reelected and probably beyond. And to be honest, I think it inures to the president's benefit. I mean, all this back and forth and, you know, political posturing, I think people see through it.
We need a much more clear direction for the Democrats to make some decisions and to kind of grab him if they're going to grab him. And if not, it becomes muddied and the public perception will be just that. The danger for Trump is in that financial report by the New York Times, because his base will not understand how you get away with not paying taxes when they're struggling.
And now, New York State is passing a bill that will permit give authorization to release those returns, we'll learn more about his taxes in the past.
Is that the best thing? I don't want my taxes revealed to somebody else. I'm not the president of the United States, neither are you. But what is the government doing? You want to get the guy, you got him on the destruction of democracy and the interference with the Russians. What are you doing? Get to the point. He did it. It's an admission.
Well, I also agree with Hank in that, this is just the entire government, now state governments are shutting down, doing the work of the people because they want to get Trump. Right? I mean, on his tax returns, on everything else, you know, we're going to subpoena his kids. The state attorney general is going after him now. I mean, there's nothing in New York that needs fixing. Give me a break.
Well, whether it needs fixing or not, it doesn't seem to be a good use of time. And you're right about, you may be right about that. But again, the real issue is democracy. And that Russia engagement is now, you know, the intelligence chiefs have said it. This guy was responsible. We have to protect our democracy. Money aside, that's the issue, and that's what the Congress ought to be focusing on.
The story is not going away. Hank Chapin, thank you so much for joining
us.
We're going to take a break. Come back and talk about the crisis in public housing. We'll be right back. The 400,000 tenants of the city's public housing developments survived another winter, but not without hardship. Many still suffer from lead and mold exposure, heating outages, broken elevators, and leaky roofs. It'll still take $32 billion over the next 5 years to make all the necessary repairs. To update us on the latest developments, I'm pleased to be joined by my colleague, Monica Morales, who has been a strong advocate for tenants, and her Monica Makes It Happen segments on PIX 11 News have helped correct a number of the problems in those buildings. Carmen Quninones is the president of the Douglas Houses Tenants Association, and Reverend David Brawley is with Metro IAF, a tenant advocacy group with more than 120 congregations, schools, homeowners associations, and senior centers. Thank you for coming in. How would you assess the situation? Has it gotten any better since the federal monitor has taken over?
Well, if you look at Channel 2 yesterday, you will see that the rehabs on 93rd Street have been without gas since last November.
We did a gas story, too, by the way.
Right?
So we're doing
so
gas stories,
is
too.
It getting better?
No.
No, it's not getting better. It's going to be worse before it does get better, though.
It's still underfunded. You need a total of $32
billion. Definitely.
Is the figure you need over a five-year period to make those repairs.
Definitely.
The mayor had promised to make a number of repairs, particularly boilers in these buildings, last summer. Did that ever happen?
Marvin, we shouldn't even talk about this mayor because he is just out of touch. I think he's ADD. I think he needs to get checked.
Well, let me just also interject by saying it's a chronic problem. The problem is a lack of leadership from City Hall. This mayor has provided absolutely no leadership when it comes down to working with tenants, to working with the situations that are happening with our congregants. He's done almost nothing to remedy the situation.
Now, one of the, they talked about a big fix, the 2.0 plan.
Yeah.
And part of it calls taking care of, well, NYCHA's greatest asset, that's land. They want to knock down some buildings?
Right now, they want to blow up Fulton
houses
right now. They want to blow those up. People are up in armor. I just went to a rally over there, and the tenants are just, they're going crazy.
Well, yeah. They want to demolish two buildings and put up new housing that would provide 1,000 units.
Well, you tell me, if you do demolish that, where are you going to put these people? This is another tactic of privatization and displacement. What's going to happen, this mayor is creating is homelessness. That is what he's creating. And he has this big thing about homelessness. I don't understand. You can't serve two masters. What is it?
You know what's interesting, Marvin, is that in all of the conversations they talk about resident engagement, and I don't see a lot of resident engagement. Even senior centers being closed. There's 14 that are set to close, and even the CEO, the interim CEO, Catherine Garcia, in the hearing said, you know what? We haven't done resident engagement. So what is that about, making these huge decisions without enough resident engagement?
Resident engagement, I was with the monitor yesterday, and I also had a meeting with Lynn Patton. And we're in touch, I mean, and they're working very hard to get to these problems. Resident engagement has been a mess. All of New York City housing is a mess, and they have to clean it from the bottom up. They have to get rid of all these people that have caused this. Because what they're doing, Marvin, is they want the, they want these buildings to fall apart so that they can privatize. And that's what 2.0 is.
So it's just repackaging. Next gen, 2.0.
Infill.
Call it 5.0. Call it whatever you want to call it. It's inaction. It's disrespect. And so when you think about it, some years ago, they were talking about $17 billion. Was what it was going to take. Now the number is $32 billion, and it goes up exponentially. When nothing is being done, it's a great cost to our citizens.
You know, we're going to talk about something else, too, because now they're talking about eliminating senior centers. They're talking about eliminating 14 senior centers.
It's unbelievable. It's unbelievable. Taking away from communities that already don't have much and are suffering. And they're saying there isn't enough people actually going to these senior centers. But, hey, that's because they're not built. They're not developed. They're not, there's not, they're not nurtured by funds and by energy and by management. So
now, you covered a rally down at City Hall just the other day.
I did. The Reverend's rally.
When you were there, let's take a look at it, and we'll talk about that afterwards. Sure. Here's the report Monica filed the other day.
Inside the City Council executive budget hearing Tuesday, NYCHA interim CEO Catherine Garcia in the hot seat once again.
Those are your buildings, and so therefore you should know what's happening in your buildings.
Garcia fielded tough questions from the City Council, this time about money. And fallout from the news that up to 14 NYCHA senior centers across the city are set to be closed or consolidated to save $885,000. PIX 11 first told you about the potential budget cuts last week. While the mayor has said in the past there will be a cost-effective new approach to providing seniors in public housing with access to senior centers, Garcia said this Tuesday about the cuts.
We have not done any resident engagement. We were only recently informed that the city was not funding.
Meantime, outside on the steps of City Hall, the seniors who live in NYCHA made sure their voices were heard.
We want the aspiring presidential candidate to come to grips with this cold, hard reality. The tale of two cities.
NYCHA tenants and pastors with Metro Industrial Areas Foundation and East Brooklyn congregations say with this handshake last year, Mayor Bill de Blasio promised $500 million for new senior housing in NYCHA, money they haven't seen yet.
Mayor de Blasio, we're giving you 1 month to restore the $500 million from last year. And the number went up another $500 million for this year. That's $1 billion.
And the seniors are here. They say they have a message for the mayor. Show them the money for more senior housing.
We need to keep some of those promises.
And a spokesperson for the office of the mayor says, quote, our commitment is the same today as it was last June. We are developing 6 public sites with 1,000 homes for seniors. We recognize there was public confusion about the details of this plan, and we wish he had communicated better from the start, but we never backtracked on our commitment.
And the mayor says he's not backtracking, and we'll hear what his panel has to say, but first let's take a break. We'll be right back. Back now with Reverend David Brawley and Carmen Quninones and my colleague Monica Morales talking about the crisis in public housing, the report we saw Monica filed a moment ago, talking about affordable housing. You guys are looking for funds, you say the mayor promised to give you $500 million to build more housing for senior citizens.
Correct. So,
but you're not getting it.
We're not getting it's, it. It was supposed to be in this previous budget. It's not there. Scott Stringer, comptroller, he looked for it. Requested of the mayor, where is it? It's not in the budget. It was promised. Last June, we shook hands on the steps of City Hall with Mayor de Blasio, and he promised the money. He's reneging on that deal. October 9th, 2017, 6,000 leaders came out, predominantly seniors, asking, fighting, and struggling for this money. The promise was made last June, and now the money is not there. We're going to go to this mayor in a mass demonstration. We're going to Gracie Mansion. Seniors are going. They want to be there. They were there in that report, 500 strong.
But the mayor says he's not backtracking on his commitment. You say he owes you $500 million he pledged last year, and you want another $500 million on top of that.
No, he did not come up with the first pledge, $500 million. It's not in the budget. He's talking about 1,000 units that was already a part of a previous plan, but no new monies have been set aside for the housing that we've been talking about and we agreed upon and shook hands with this mayor. He's lying and reneging
on us. So that's about building new housing.
It's about building new housing. It's about also helping our folks who are in homeless shelters have a place to live, because when a senior gets moved out of a larger apartment and into a new senior affordable development, what happens is you make room for folks who are homeless. You make room for folks on the waiting list. 65,000 New Yorkers every single day in this city don't have a place to live, living in homeless shelters. This mayor has let this city down. It's gotten worse. The Tale of Two Cities has not gotten better. It's gotten worse under Bill de Blasio.
Marvin, this is the perfect plan. If you want to build housing that's affordable.
Yes.
Because most of our residents that live in public housing, most of them are seniors. Mm. So what's going to happen to them? The perfect plan is not the 2.0. It's senior housing. Build senior housing. We make room in public housing for other people to come in.
That's right.
Okay? What has to happen is we have to shut this city down. That's what has to happen. Let's shut it down.
And you feel that.
You're talking about a tenant strike?
I'm not talking about a tenant strike. I'm talking about tenants shut the city down.
Okay.
We've been planning it for a while. Okay. Falani, myself, and a couple of other presidents have been planning. I hope to get together with you, because I know you got
Let me just be really clear. Let me be really clear. To this mayor, you have 1 month to put the money back, $500 million, and then another $500 million, or the largest demonstration you've ever seen is coming to
your city.
And I believe it, Mark. You should have seen City Hall that day.
We're going to shut it down.
200 to 300 seniors were at City Hall, were in that hearing. Hundreds had to be turned away, and they are serious. I saw it for myself that day at City Hall. And they were able to do a rally that was bigger than the Columbus Day Parade. So, and there's this anger that is just percolating. And now it's ready for the uprising.
I have asked Carmen, because you had spoken to Secretary of Housing, Ben Carson. He was here, and he was sympathetic to what's going on here. Right. But also, you got to the White House, and you had a moment to speak to President Trump.
Yes, I did.
And would you share that with us?
At first, they thought it was just going to be a photo shot. When I got in there, and they told me just turn around and get this photo shot, I was like, I'm not here for that. I'm here to talk about public housing. And the first thing he told me was, I said, listen, I want you to commit to helping public housing. I need the first lady to come and visit the parents of the children that have let. She promised to do that. We're working on that. Spoke with Lynn yesterday. And we're working on the first lady to come. The other thing is that Pence, I spent more time with Pence than I did with
Vice
Trump.
President.
And
he's very interested.
So they're very interested. He was very interested in helping out.
Did you get any commitments from him?
The commitment was to help us up. For me to work with Lynn to do whatever we need to do. Okay. And I've been working with Lynn closely.
Sure. Any further? I want to get to one other thing because of that tragedy this week in the NYCHA house.
We have to talk about that.
And I do want to talk about, because it was made clear that you do have the smoke detectors and carbon monoxide detectors in those units.
Sometimes you do and sometimes you don't. So,
what is the status of that?
I don't know the status of that, but I really believe that it was the hot plate that set that fire.
But are the apartments adequately protected with these detectors?
Well,
in the NYCHA house, what about yours?
Some of them are. I mean, I gotta say, some of them are.
Does they have to
but
be a
some
call?
Of them not, because they don't do the inspections the way they're supposed to. So if they don't inspect, you don't know if they have a carbon dioxide. You don't know if they have those.
How can you trust anything
you can't
from
trust
this
NYCHA.
Administration when
but in
they've
this
lied
case,
about
apparently,
lead paint? They've lied about all kinds of inspections being done. People have lost jobs over
and nobody's gone to jail, Scott.
But, and no one's going to
prison. But apparently in this case, tragedy, this woman apparently disconnected the... But I was asking if the NYCHA units are equipped with this. You say some are and some are not.
Yes.
Carmen.
Exactly.
Quninones, it's always good to have you on the program.
Thank
and
you
Reverend
so
Brawley, thank you. And, of course, Monica Morales, you can
Thanks
see
for
our
having
news
us
broadcast.
On.
Monica makes it happen.
Right.
And that'll do it for our program for this week. If you have any comments or wish to see the broadcast again, log on to our website at pix11.com/newsclose-up. I'm Marvin Scott. Thanks so much for joining us. Enjoy the rest of your Sunday, everyone.